about this is you can't ask me for a cigarette. So you can't talk. And I don't have any.
That's murder.
Festa at the Round Hole Big Joint Number 1 exhibition and performance.
We're
going to talk to the artists to have them describe a little bit about their work, their themes, and their collaboration.
So I met Mike in grad school, and I got to see him do some work. I thought it was like raw, I thought it was interesting, challenging work. He moved to Korea and was teaching there for a while. And then he came back. I had a show recently in Manhattan Beach that I did with an artist, Walpa DeMarc, that was a collaboration, and I met Mike there. So we decided to kind of meet, and I got to see his work and hang out in his studio. And I was like really impressed by the fact, the thing that he was interested in, he had kept doing since grad school. And it kind of like really solidified how serious he was about what he does and what I felt the work was about. You know, considering like how, it just kind of came at an interesting time. So after we hung out and talked, you know, I talked about his work a little bit and he seemed to feel that I had a good understanding of what was going on, and then kind of came up with the idea for doing this.
The conversation that we had when we first started to get to know each other in the initial studio visit really was the ignition point for this piece itself, because during the studio visit I spoke to David in such a way that he brought up that the kind of work that I did and performance work along the lines of Dan Graham when I was in graduate school was one of the things that drew him to my practice as a whole. And from there, while he was driving home that night, he asked if I wanted to collaborate with him on a project. And needless to say, it definitely turned out to be quite a big endeavor. We met the second time and he brought to the studio a proposal kind of outlining what he saw we could do as a collaborative work.
It was very formal too. I liked how Mike wanted the requests. He wanted them in writing. And he wanted to talk about the ideas, and I sent something over, and you know, he read it, and then he sent something back, and it just seemed like, you know, from our brief couple of meetings that, you know, we should have a longer conversation, and we did, and we spent I think an entire day talking about art, and I don't think there was one thing that we didn't talk about that we weren't both really engaged with. I had been meeting with people, artists here in LA, that were willing. There were a couple of artists that I met with, Annie Neiman and Walpa DeMarc, that I made it a point to meet with them like at least once or twice a month, and sometimes more, 3-4 times a week. And I found that dialogue was very sort of essential, because there was sort of a lot of struggles that were happening in, you know, with people trying to make work and how challenging it was, that even just talking with artists was important. It had kind of ceased at that point because me and Walpa had sort of concluded our collaboration and Annie had some other things that were going on. And then to have that with Mike consistently for long periods of time, I think we met at least once a week, and then we talked for as long as we needed to talk about the work. So a lot of good ground laying for the sculpture.
Yeah.
So tell me about the process of putting this exhibition together.
It's interesting to look at the initial proposals and the subsequent drawings that came out of it, especially the 8-hour-long conversations that we had at times in preparation for the 5 days of performance. I don't want to get too into detail about how it was initially, but the structure, the gallery and studio kind of bifurcation,
yeah,
or you know, unification, whatever you want to consider it, has been there from the beginning, but it was a bit more like the audience was being encapsulated than the artist. And I feel that in the permutations that came out of that initial fabrication, developed into what it is now, and what it is now is more about the artist's practice and the audience member's actual engagement and tangible participation than simply experiencing art as a two-dimensional experience.
I think I can like sum it up, I feel like, pretty good, of like what I got from it, and you might agree with it, but I feel that from the get-go, the way that we had started talking about working together, it was like consciousness raising for each other. It was building each other up with the things that we were already doing. And at one point, we had discussed a sort of follow-through, like what happens next with this work, and we had talked about sort of the core thing that we felt that we both were vibing on, and it was this need for artists to work together, talk together, for people to communicate. And I feel like that process was what happened, where we both were becoming sort of transformed, the work was transforming us, we were challenging each other, and then that really is, you know, the other sort of narrative packaging that is around the work, the idea of Mike is like an Alice in Wonderland type of thing, and all of this stuff, it really was fueled by that. And I feel that that's, you know, we really got to see that with people's participation. And I think that process just carried through. Kind of
so did you pitch this idea to other galleries? Were you trying to get into a gallery, or was your initial intention to create a gallery in the studio space?
Well, we did. I think that was part of the challenge for each other, was we kind of egged each other on to go sort of use all of our resources that we had. And so that was a good practice. I had never done that. And it's something I always wanted to do. And I was thinking to myself, I kind of was hoping, like, if I just had one person to go do, this was before Mike and I did it. I just thought to myself, if I had one person to do this with, I totally would go pitch. And we did. And based on those conversations with people in galleries, you know, we were sort of looking at using this as a satellite space and sort of trafficking people from those galleries here. To the show, and then through a couple of those discussions, it was pretty, kind of came to this idea of a pop-up gallery. We spoke with somebody else who was sort of encouraging me and Mike to actually open a gallery, and then once we kind of went through actually opening a gallery, at one point it was like, well, what's actually going to distinguish us from having the same sort of challenges that a regular one would. We wouldn't. We'd have the same ones because we'd have to have space. So if we're looking to do something that's really like that's kind of against the grain, if we're looking to sort of develop a language that's not necessarily made to sell, which is what, you know, a lot of some of the conversations, I think both the people we were talking, there was a type of like, you know, what can you do for me? I need to sell work, type of thing.
So it makes sense that you create a gallery space
yeah.
in here.
Right.
So this, I see there's work on the walls, there's installations, there's sculptures, and there's also a 5-day performance. Do you want to walk us through each day of that performance?
We started off with Still Life Day, and Still Life Day was a way for David and I to see how people observe and also to engage in the initial act of an artist, which is observation. So many artists start their careers in still life drawing class, getting the rudiments of hand-eye coordination, drawing with pencils, and, you know, documenting what they see. So we wanted to get an idea of how people would document this. And in this day of Snapchat and social media, Instagram, kind of taking pictures of everything, we wanted people to give it a chance to be still and just be with the work.
So that was day one.
It was Mike. He did individual meetings with people that signed up for about 25 minutes here in the studio. And he had a variety of tools that he used. One of the things with producing this work was about sort of like casting Mike in this sort of customized role for him. You know, and one way to do that was we made books of his work that then had a narrative quality to it. And the books, you know, while they have this sort of formal thing that bring in a narrative, you know, on Shaman Day, he was using those books as a kind of tool to sort of do like consciousness raising exercises with people.
It was to simply create a dialogue, and what I got out of it was a very open audience. I performed the ritual with a whole gamut of people, from those that I've known personally and I speak on very intimate terms with on a more than weekly basis, and also those who I had a friend bring, someone who I'd never met before. And even though I just met this person on the sidewalk and brought him upstairs, in the session they were extremely open and evocative, and everyone on a whole, they were more open to me than I'd ever been with anyone else, it seemed.
Do you feel that was transformative?
Yeah, absolutely. I was very changed by how honest these people were being. Even if there was something that was completely left unsaid, their micro expressions, their body language still kind of laid claim to what was behind their thoughts and thinking. And it was wonderful to see art facilitate that and be that therapeutic tool. And instead of me being the shaman and going to a trance-like state to kind of guide them or heal them, it was a way of them actually coming into this state of questioning and pouring out. So with that kind of openness, we went into to day three, which was work day. And work day was another way of interacting with the audience, but instead of on a one-on-one basis, like Shaman Day, with the gallery empty except me and the person who was doing the performance, work day was a bigger effort because
it's kind of a corporate, everybody, yeah. a group effort. We had a comedian in here doing his stand-up, which was also part of that. That was a customized, so I mean, we did the Shaman Day, but the sculpture itself, the entire sculpture itself, there were positions that people inhabited. Like I see Mike as the central centrifuge of this entire sculpture. And on Shaman Day, he was in the sculpture doing Mike Haight's work. And then other people, our friend Javier, he's a comedian, and he was doing his material one night for us off his cell phone, and not in the sculpture, just separately hanging out. And you know, he was sort of talking about like how he wants to get good at doing comedy, and so we both kind of like had a thought and talked about it later and said, why don't you become part of the sculpture and practice your set? So he did his set through the whole night, which was nice, because when there was this like, there was never any negative, or there was never any blank space. It was always something sort of going.
That was
on work day.
Yeah, and like with work day came that kind of building up of the sculpture so that there is no, you know, blank space. You look around and there's so much everywhere that it would take a long time to decompartmentalize everything. And so after the calm of Shaman Day, work day was, you know, it was an 8-hour long performance. It was an entire shift. And we had people come in and produce. We made these large carrots, and we interacted with the money, made sculptures out of the money.
People used the money. That we did something like money therapy, which was sort of, you know, people giving them the leeway to sort of like throw these bills that we made up in the air, make it rain, tear the money, draw on the money, really interacting with money. That was something kind of personal for me that I like sort of made it into the show, was that, you know, thinking about money as a sculptural object with all the ritual that it has around it.
So day four?
Yeah, day four, this was sort of from our conversations with the two gallery owners that we had, and then a faculty member that we both respected and spent time with, and it was to turn Mike's studio into a pop-up gallery. So he chose to, you know, he's in this box made of drywall that's, you know, it's 4x4x4, but then 8 feet high around, And then we sort of had drilled these peepholes for him to like interact with the audience. And then we put carrots in the holes, and then other things sort of in the holes. And he said to make 100 paintings in, I think,
4 hours.
In 4 hours. So there's this like production that's going on. And then outside of here, it was kind of like, you know, keeping people engaged. We had talked about really trying to sell sort of the work.
I know there was a lot of people involved in that night.
Yeah.
What was interesting about this performance on production day is that it required 6 simultaneous performances. We had a receptionist role, we had the gallerist or dealer role, we had a role for providing soundtrack, a role for documenting and being part of the disembodied rabbit, and the role of comedian.
Well, the comedian was part of the disembodied rabbit was really, it kind of came from a couple places. It was one, it was me thinking about like artists that are sort of like collected right now and they continue to sell work, and their use of like Jeff Koons and the Energizer Bunny, and sculptors tend to use it. Like Jason Rhodes used it, made some references to Jeff Koons. But then we had sort of come upon, we both enjoyed Joseph Boys, but I had never seen his rabbit performance that he had done. And so this whole one big sort of part of that, his work is transformation. And he did a piece with a rabbit, teaching a rabbit how to look at images, you know, and the rabbit was dead. It's sort of this whole piece kind of became, in one sense, a revamp on kind of like steroids of that piece, where now instead of him teaching a dead rabbit, we're teaching dead viewers how to look at real art. And so viewers coming in, the rabbit that we had was a kind of like homage, or it was me taking over the Energizer Bunny, which I renamed Hip Hop. And there were, you know, we had a bodysuit. The comedian was sweating in the bodysuit doing his comedy. The AV guy was wearing the head, you know, doing all the audiovisual stuff. Mike was kind of like the spirit of the rabbit, and then we had like kind of helpers. You know, the whole thing was kind of like that rabbit, but then the viewer was the rabbit. So that was production day.
And so today is the 5th day, mm-hmm. Day.
Right.
So you guys mentioned the rabbit, and influence of boys. Would you like to talk about the title of this piece, The Rabbit Hole?
Yeah, so what this kind of came about, I mean, this is, the title of the show is Big Joint Number One, and it's definitely a big joint. It was a lot of talk and a lot of preparation that came into these 5 days. And we kind of worked backwards from the question of what would Martin Kippenberger and Joseph Boys talk about if they smoked a joint. For me, to think about the conversation they have would be better than, you know, the having dinner with Jesus, or whenever someone wants to have a dinner with a dead person. I'd rather just watch Kippenberger and Joseph Boys smoke a joint and what would ensue from that.
Well, I think the selection of those artists too, you know, you said we worked reverse, and it was more like we made this work, and then at the end, you said Kippenberger Boys, and one of the people that we'd been talking to that was telling us to start a gallery, and then it kind of became the Kippenberger Boys Gallery, Big Joint Number One. But the selection of those two artists, when you said that at the time here in the studio, you know, I care a lot about identity and other people having a voice. I think that was something that people got to have their voice, especially on workday. You know, some people grabbed the mic, other people were making, but they felt, so that was really important. But as being like Caucasian male, heterosexual, you know, the sort of theme of this work centering around fostering a type of creative sort of catalyst for people. It sort of really is being very respectful of other people's voices and their work. and sort of pointing to two artists that you could look at.
Can you tell me a little bit about the Gismont Coons work in this case?
The overarching work is the dialogue, I would say. It is, for me, the performance of practice, or the performance of this rabbit hole piece, is that it creates dialogue. I strive to paint or draw or create in order to communicate, not to necessarily relay a message, but to invigorate a question in a viewer's mind, or to create a conversation between myself and the other person, be they an artist in collaboration with myself, or they are a recipient of a letter or an image or a viewer in a gallery.
For me, that we started to experience this on Talk Day today, which was very magical to me. The magic was happening because we've been having people kind of come in to look at the work that, you know, they're not really sitting listening to the talk, they're kind of staying in the background. But this activity that we're doing, for some people, I can tell, it's charging the work in anti-aesthetic. And I think that's very, for me, that's the whole sort of overarching theme, is using performance and sculpture to charge two-dimensional work that's anti-aesthetic, to get people to, kind of, I guess, be more malleable when it comes to maybe, if it's a stand-in for an ideology, visually, things that aren't pleasing, to them maybe dealing with ideas. So I think that's a very strong kind of metaphor.
It definitely, for the layperson who isn't arts educated, to come in and see how art can be presented in a way that is other or alternative to a very white cube
market-oriented
aesthetic.
Buying and selling.
Is definitely an experience that we wanted others to see, especially those who don't come from the art world.
Well, great, thank you so much. It was great to hear what went into this work and the thought behind it.
Absolutely.
So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Whitney.